morning, Lake Grove. Oh, what a joy it is to be here with you all this morning on the third Sunday of Eastertide. What a joy it is that we get to gather together in such a beautiful, sacred space to worship the Lord, the living Lord, together. I extend a welcome, of course, to all of you in the room and, of course, to all of you who are joining us online. We're so glad that you are with us this morning. A couple of things from the life of the church I want to invite you to. It might be the third Sunday of Eastertide, but it's the second Sunday of the month, which means our fabulous LGK team has put together a wonderful intergenerational event. And so after service, you are invited to bagels and building. If you love Legos, there's all sorts of things to build with over in the fellowship hall, and there's bagels and cream cheese, a favorite of most of us. And we invite you to head over there and just enjoy being creative and spending time together. It is an exciting year for us as we celebrate our centennial 100 years of the Lord's faithfulness in this place. As part of our celebration next Sunday, we'll gather to build 100-plus child hygiene kits for World Vision, and this will be at 10:30 in the courtyard room. So right after service, we'll go do that. And then immediately following, we'll continue with our monthly lecture series. This time, it will be presented by Mike Bays here at 11 a.m., and it will go over the war years. So we invite you to stay for that. Men of Lake Grove, we invite you to the men's retreat. And actually, right as you go outside, there's the information desk into that gathering area. Dan Schmidt is sitting there ready to take your registration and answer any questions that you have about that. It is titled Following Christ as Faithful LGPC Men, Past, Present, and Future. And that's Saturday, April 27th from 12:30 to 4:30. Here's a fun thing. It will be over in the fellowship hall, and afterward, families are invited to come join in a barbecue for that. Cost is $20. You can just go register right outside. And then finally, family camp. Are you looking for a meaningful activity for your family to do together? July 27th, LGK is hosting a family camp at Shampooey Park. It will be a fun day of games, hiking and biking, fellowship, and more. You can register on the website and see all the good details about that. So lots of things to do together in the life of the church today. I invite you now to stand to your feet and let us call ourselves to worship. Give thanks. God pours out his great extravagant love for us.
We are witnesses to this love.
Our hearts have been changed and our lives shaped by the grace of God.
We testify to God's transformative grace.
We believe Christ will come again and that all of creation will be renewed.
Let us bear witness to the truth through worship.
Thank you.
Almighty God of wisdom and courage, we have been witness to your great grace and beauty through the majesty of Easter echoed through this beautiful spring. We have been witness to your love through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. You are the God who comes near, the God who sees, who names, who encourages, who lifts up, who heals and renews. You are the one who forgives and instructs and the one who leads. Hear our love for you this morning. Hear our joy at what we have seen of your saving work and open our eyes anew to your presence in our midst. Hallelujah and amen. Be seated. We breathe in deeply the grace of God. I invite you to pray with me a prayer of confession and to bring as much of yourself as you can to as much of the Lord that you know. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the grave, you shattered the power of sin and death. We confess that it is so easy to remain captive when you have said we are free. It is so easy to give the evil in front of us more power than your glory and grave-defying life that surrounds us and which you invite us to share with you. It's so easy to hide from you, from the truth of our lives, both in their great beauty and their brokenness. Help us see rightly. We confess that we are often halfway here, halfway not, kind of with you, kind of not. Free us, please, from all that would keep us from embracing the life that you have given us, one where we are active participants, bearing responsibility and joy, people fully forgiven and free, alive, abiding in you. We take a moment of silence before you. Amen. In the Gospel of John, our good shepherd Jesus says this to us: "Oh, the thief only comes to steal and kill and destroy, but I have come that you might have life and have it to the full." Know that through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven, renewed, set free. Be at peace. Let's stand and sing. Friends, the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Please share the peace of Christ with one another. There is a lot of peace and a lot of joy to be had this morning. I am so excited to invite the Lina Weber family forward to join us for the baptism of Elliot and Patrick. Oh, yes, uh-huh. Welcome. We are so glad that you are gathered with us. And here, this is a very special day indeed. All right, and if you lose it, I'm going to lose it, so nobody lose it. Or maybe let's all lose it, because it is worth losing it over. Oh, the great grace and of God that is with us. Friends, in Ephesians, it says this: there's one body and one spirit. just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father above all, who is above all and through all and in all. In baptism, God claims us. God seals us, shows us that we belong to God forever. What a beautiful gift it is as we baptize that it is a way of saying and of showing that the Lord's great love reaches for us before we ever had any chance to reach for God. God has always been and claims and called us. I invite you today as you witness this baptism, which also ushers us into being members of the church, to be people who live God's grace and love and peace and justice. Would you remember the joy of your own baptism as we celebrate this one today? Lynn?
On behalf of Lake Grove Session, I present my grandchildren. So Elliot and Patrick Lineweber, daughter and son of Laura and Charlie Lineweber, for the sacrament of baptism.
Thank you. So we have a few questions for you. Do you desire that Ellie and Patrick be baptized? Relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian faith and to teach that faith to your children? Do you? Lynn, you have a question.
And I do. I have a question for you. Do we, the members of Lake Grove Presbyterian Church, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide, thank you, then nurture Elliot and Patrick by word and deed, with love and prayer, encouraging them to know and follow Christ and to be faithful members of Christ's church? Do we?
We do.
A
couple more questions for you two. Through the sacrament of baptism, we enter the covenant God established in Jesus Christ. Within this covenant, God gives us new life, strengthens us to resist evil, and nurtures us in love. Do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you? Do you trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, renouncing sin and choosing instead to live in his grace and love? Do you? Relying on God's help, do you promise to live out the Christian faith, to nurture your children in a way that when they are older, they too will hopefully trust Jesus as their Savior? Will you? I'd like to pray over this water here. Do you want to move close with me, Ellie? We'll move close, and here comes the water. Beloved Lord, we are thankful for this gift of water. You have given us this water that nourishes us. We need it for life. And you, God, invite us into your life. Through this water, will you so move and fill Ellie and Patrick that they would know their whole life long that they belong to you? And would you knit this body of people, gathered, yes, in this place, but all over the world as your church, unite us even closer to live your love. In the powerful name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Oh, dear Ellie, I baptize you in the name of the Father and in the name of the Son. And in the name of the Holy Spirit, you, dear one, are a child of God, forever the Lord's, beautiful and free, fully God's. Patrick, yes, there's a beautiful choir back there. It's amazing, isn't it? And then look at this. You, dear Patrick, are so dearly loved. Patrick Robert, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Spirit. You, dear one, belong to God, forever claimed in the family of faith. How beautiful it is, friends, that we are called children of God indeed. That is who we are. Oh, friends, we're going to pray a blessing, and then I'm going to have you welcome them with exuberance I know you feel. So may I put my hand on your head, Ellie? Oh, beloved Lord, these two precious ones created in your very image, would you so bless them throughout their whole life that they can hardly ever even doubt that of your love and your grace moving through them? Knit them closely with you. Let them hear your voice, know your way, walk in your way. We pray this in the powerful name of Christ. Amen. Amen. Friends, would you welcome the newly baptized? It's really hard to let you go. I invite you, please, to greet them after the service as well and welcome them into the family of faith. We're going to stand now and sing, but I want you to know we're going to sing hymn number 482. It's the same one listed, the title's right, just flip to 482. Be seated. We turn to the Lord in prayer one more time. Oh, holy God, it is right to give you thanks and praise, for you are the God of life, the God of all creation and the God of new creation. Let us live in resurrection joy, oh, witnessing your life-giving love. We praise and thank you for the joy of baptism, the enfolding into your family and your kingdom. As your people, God, we lift our hearts to you for a world that aches, one that is filled with war and strife. We lift these warring places to you and ask for your divine intervention, that there be no more escalation, that a path of peace would be found, that you would give wisdom to all human leaders in finding another way. We pray, Lord, for all that seems so far from us, that we have no control over, that we have no influence on, but yet affects us so deeply. This shows us how you have made us. We lift all these conflicts and fears to you, whether they be far, and Lord, the ones that are close in, and even closer still, especially we lift to you and ask for healing in our hearts, our souls, our minds, and in our strength. We lift up those among us who are standing at the edge of this life and the life to come, their family that is by their bedside, walking with them through these precious hours and days. Give them each a palpable sense of your presence and of your peace that passes understanding. And for those who grieve, dear Lord, we lift the Alexander family to you as they grieve the death of Lisa's father, David. Lord, comfort them as only you can. Help us be a comfort to them, to one another too. And now, as your people, we pray together the prayer you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, good morning, all. That includes those of you here, too. Let's pray one more time as we come to the Lord's message to us today. Lord, we are here to listen. Let all the extra thoughts and things that might be vying for our attention fall away. May we hear you clearly, be changed by the words that we hear. And Lord, may those things then grow into good fruit in our lives. Amen. Our passage today is Acts 1, 6 through 11. Hear now the word of the Lord. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you'll restore the kingdom to Israel? And he replied, It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who's been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. It's the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, as some of you may already know, I had the privilege of traveling recently with our Guatemala Go team. Any of my teammates here today? Are you here? Behind me. Yay, Michelle. I should have looked. I knew you were there. Well, we went to see and experience and learn firsthand all about the work Agros is doing in a northern region of the country called the Ashiel. And Agros is one of our international mission partners. So the Go team got to meet the Agros staff, and we got to hear what motivates them. And it is the love of Christ. That is what motivates them in their work. Through a variety of initiatives, children receive health care, and mothers are supported in learning about nutrition. Women are empowered to become entrepreneurs. And as a result, the children now have access to a level of education not previously possible. Men are able to stay in their own communities instead of having to travel off to find migrant opportunities. and they're joining their wives in business. They're learning about agriculture and how technology can benefit their work. How do I know these things? As Michelle knows these things, because we saw them firsthand. We saw the smiles of the children as they played and learned in their preschools. We heard the pride and gratitude in the voices of the women as they talked about how Agros microloans had allowed them to begin enterprises that literally changed their lives. It changed the trajectory of their entire families. And I've seen the deep commitment that the Agros staff has to the people in the communities in the Ashiel. I am a witness to the life-altering work of Agros in Guatemala. It's an organization motivated by the love of Christ. And this week, I have delighted especially in imagining Jesus thinking of the Ashiel people as he told his disciples that they would be witnesses to the ends of the earth. I don't know that he actually thought of the Ashiel, but maybe. Maybe he did. Maybe he thought of all the peoples to come. Regardless, I have seen the truth of God's love being lived out with fervor in the Ashiel. It's one of those little places at the ends of the earth. I bear witness to it. The directive Jesus gives his disciples to bear witness to the wonders that God has done is a reframing of the role that Israel has had all along. And I've got a little bit of nerdy word fun for you today, a little Hebrew, a little Greek, if you like that thing. In the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, the Hebrew word aid is used to describe someone as a witness. When they carry out their task of sharing what they've seen, or which is the bearing witness part, they are called ood. And we see many examples of this description because Yahweh had chosen Israel to be his people, to be a kingdom of priests that others might see and know God, that they would bear witness. And then we have specific individuals who fill that role of aid, such as Moses and the prophets. Think about Isaiah, all of those guys. When we move to the New Testament, we do switch to Greek, but the word carries through and becomes martus, which identifies witness. Jesus is God's ultimate witness, who then shares truth with his disciples that they may effectively bear witness, or martyreo, both near and far. The word witness carries through all of Scripture, from the Old Testament to the New, always pointing to a group of individual who has firsthand knowledge of who God is, what God has done, is doing, and has promised to do. He's called his people to be witnesses all along. So to what exactly did Jesus' disciples bear witness? Luke, the author of today's passage in Acts, also recorded Jesus' words in his gospel. So in Luke 24, you hear Jesus saying, "Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." And then he opened their minds so they could understand Scripture. And he told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer, rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses to these things." For 3 years, the disciples witnessed how Jesus fulfilled what had been written and prophesied about the Messiah. They saw him perform miracles, forgive sins, love the unlovable, and speak without fear to those in power. He lived an embodied life, fully God, fully man. They even knew what he sounded like when he sang, the way he held his face when he was thinking. They'd seen his mother Mary cluck over him the way us mothers tend to do, even when our kids are all grown up. But the disciples were also witnesses to Jesus as he taught about the establishment of a new kingdom of God, which he was king. The disciples were called to be heralds of this new kingship and all the gritty and the glorious details that came along with it. They had witnessed Jesus' resurrection, 40 days worth of talking and eating and hanging out with their risen Lord. They experienced the literal earth-shaking, life-saving, and eternal implications of Jesus' victory over death. Before he went to be with his Father, Jesus' final words to his disciples were perhaps a little bit surprising. We heard him say, "You will receive power by the Holy Spirit that has come upon you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." Matthew also records this commissioning in chapter 28. He says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit," just like happened over here today, "and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And remember, I'm with you always, to the ends of the age." So we have all nations, to the ends of the earth, to the ends of the age. Jesus was not simply asking them to testify to their neighbors and friends and fellow Jews. He was making it clear that this work was going to take them to places that they maybe didn't really want to go, to people they didn't really care for, such as with the people of Samaria. The Jews had significant animosity and prejudice against them. And maybe to places they'd never dreamed of, places different and unknown, with different languages and different cultures. And I think of the Ashiel again and my experiences to the ends of the earth. Jesus commanded his disciples. It wasn't a request. He charged them, commissioned them to this life of bearing witness. As followers of Christ today, we too are called to bear witness. To bear witness to the life of Jesus, his actions, his words, his teaching, all of it. And as with the disciples, we have the Holy Spirit to guide and empower us, and we have the confidence that Jesus is with us, just as he said. Later in Acts, Peter and the apostles find themselves before the high priest and council as a result of their dedication to being witnesses. We have an example of what being a witness really sounded like to them. So Peter says, imagine, high priest and council, "The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him to the right hand as leader and savior, that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. We're witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." Peter is speaking truth boldly to those in power, declaring Jesus Messiah, the way of salvation. And he's also proudly stating his and his disciples, not Jesus' disciples, not Peter's disciples, role as witnesses. A witness is only as effective as they are willing to share about what they've seen and experienced. The message of the gospel, the message that was shared through the witnesses of the witness of the disciples, is intended to be shared. It's good news. We don't keep good news to ourselves. We want to tell everyone. Think about Mary Magdalene, the first person to see Jesus resurrected. She couldn't keep it to herself. She was the first to bear witness that Easter morning. Being a witness is not just for those who walked with Jesus while he was on earth. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we experience and know Jesus today. Through the words of Scripture, through prayer and worship, the way God meets us in our everyday lives. Because Jesus is still at work. And those who follow Christ, we belong to the current group of witnesses. We are certainly familiar with the idea of witnessing or sharing the gospel, that verbal, intentional sharing of faith, which is good. We should. But I would argue it is not our primary way that we fulfill our role as witnesses. Because of what we have experienced, what we've come to know, our lives and our very person has been transformed. We respond to our encounter with God with worship. And following Jesus aligns our life with priorities, with Christ as the head. And we learn to live and love just as he did. Every part of how we live our lives is a witness to the transformational love and grace of Jesus. The Holy Spirit gives us courage to speak of what we've seen and experienced, and it is through the power of the Holy Spirit that people will hear, believe and respond. And I have to say that I am deeply comforted by that, because we are going to mess it up. We just will. But it is the Holy Spirit who is ultimately in charge of these works. So how do we live an effective witness? You have a guide, Holy Spirit, and you have a model, Jesus Christ, whose life is laid out for you in Scripture. Look at what Jesus taught. Look at who Jesus reached out to. Observe his priorities. Look at where he sent his disciples. This will serve as your guide. At Lake Grove, our community has dedicated significant time, energy, and resources to fulfilling Jesus' command. We partner with Christ, who transforms the world one life at a time, community at a time, and beyond. We serve with local and international mission partners as witnesses to God's love. We seek to love our neighbors as ourselves. And Jesus' words that we heard today help us to understand the scope of where are our neighbors? Who are they? When he identified Jerusalem and Judea, these point to people who are similar to ourselves, near to us. When Jesus referred to Samaria, that's to the people we don't necessarily get along with, that we may not even like. Gotta examine our hearts for our own prejudices. We're supposed to witness to them too. And then to the end of the earth. Simply put, guys, that's everywhere. That's everyone. Nobody is off the list. Teresa of Avila lived in the 16th century. She's a Carmelite nun. And she too read the words of Jesus calling her to be a witness. And we have the privilege of being able to hear her voice across the years through her writings. And she reminds us, Christ has no body on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassionately on this world. Yours are the feet with which he walks to do good. Yours are the hands with which he blesses the world. Christ has no body now on earth but yours. What a beautiful description and a beautiful reminder of how we live out our witness of what we have seen and been told and experienced. So let us be Christ's body. May we bear witness to God with us, our Savior and our friend, both here, to the ends of the earth, to the end of the age. Amen. Let's stand and sing.
Almighty God, every good gift we've received comes from you. You are our provider. Thank you for what you have given, and now we return to you a portion of that gift. Lord, that it would advance your kingdom, that it would exhibit your way. Specifically, we lift up locally here our Presbyterian Urban Network. God, for this whole set of small inner city congregations, and for Reverend Tim Winsley, who ministers to them as encourager, educator, and parish nurse, provide what they need. Set them free to live and do the work you've given them. For World Vision, Lord, we continue to lift up and pray for the children and families of Muchila, Zambia, that these lives in this community would be changed through these sponsorships here alone. Not alone. You know what I meant, Lord. We pray, God, that you would unite us together well and give great support there. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
This week will be filled with opportunities to bear witness to the love of God, the things that you personally have experienced in your life, transformation, whatever it may be. I pray that you will find those moments and live into them deeply. And may the love of the Father and the grace of the Son and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, who will be with you when you are doing these things, be with you now and always. Amen.